After giving birth to the man-child, the woman fled into the wilderness, where she hath a place prepared of God that should feed her there 1,260 days. So it was the religious system, corrupt as it may be, which had given the birth to Constantine as its champion, as its man-child. We go on in verses 7 to 11 to show the victories of Constantine and the way that paganism was overthrown. We find in verse 6 that the woman was to flee into the wilderness, where she hath a place prepared of God for a period of 1,260 days. Chapter 11. We find in verse 3 that the period 1,260 days, when a time period, if it's given in the same time setting, i.e. 1,260 days, as opposed, for example, to verse 2, when it's quoting 42 months. It's not only speaking of the time period, but it's speaking of the same events. That if an exact time period was mentioned in different places, then not only was the start and the finish point the same, but the subject matter was also the same. Whereas, if a time period was expressed in a different way, although it may be the same period of time, it may have a different start and it might have a different end, and the subject matter might also be different. So that's why in verse 2 of chapter 11, we saw that the 42 months there were different to the 1260 days in verse 3. Now this time, we've got in chapter 12 and verse 6, the same period mentioned exactly, 1,260 days. So we equate it with 1,260 days of chapter 11 and verse 3. It was relating to the time from AD 312 to AD 1572 with the great battle of St. Bartholomew, when the witnesses would prophesy for 1,260 days. And these were to witness against the power which was persecuting. Let's just read the opening verses. There was given unto me a reed like unto a rod, and the angel stood, saying, Rise and measure the temple of God, and the altar, and them that worship therein. But the court which is without the temple leave out, and measure it not, for it is given unto the Gentiles. And the holy city shall they tread under foot 42 months. And I will give power unto my two witnesses, and they shall prophesy 1,260 days, clothed in sackcloth. At that time it was the witness against the uprise of the papal system, the false church, which obviously was the persecutor of the truth. The two witnesses were equated with the earth and the woman of chapter 12 and verse 16. The earth helped the woman, and the earth opened her mouth and swallowed up the flood which the dragon cast out of his mouth. We shall come to the symbology of verse 16, but we identified the two witnesses as one, a religious power, and secondly, being helped by a more, shall we say, earthly military power. And what we found was that the people of the earth, who were ruled over by the Roman Empire, felt that the persecution of the religious power was unjust, and therefore went to its defense to help them to resist the uprise of this religious persecution. Now in chapter 12 and verse 6, we are speaking of exactly the same time period. But this time the symbology is that the woman fled into the wilderness, where she hath a place prepared of God, chapter 11 and verse 3, that they should feed her there, in other words, she should continue, that she should be supported, 1,260 days. And you might be thinking, well, that doesn't make sense at all. If the woman was a religious situation, not the truth, it was Christian based. And this Christian power, termed the woman, gave birth to Constantine, who was the champion of its cause, and it brought the relief for the woman. Why should it be necessary, therefore, for the woman to flee in the wilderness so she could be continuing there, fed of God, for 1,260 days, so she could witness against the very power she had brought to birth? And it seems, on first reading, to make nonsense of the situation. What we find in our history books is identical to the symbology we've got here in chapter 12. Because immediately taking over, as it were, as the champion of the Christian cause, Constantine was involved in what became known as the African controversy. an argument arose on a religious matter, and some were supporting one cause, and others were obviously opposing that and supporting another cause. And Constantine had to make the choice as to which one got his authority. And therefore he made a decision. And he supported, which obviously we come now today as the Catholics, he supported the one sector of his community at that time. And this great African controversy split the ecclesiastical system of the day. And because Constantine had now issued a decree that that one was right and the others were wrong, he issued another edict which said that unless the adherents were 100% behind the dogma and the thing which he had given his name to, then they were heretics. They were to be ostracized. They were to be persecuted. This African controversy came to a head very quickly, which caused Constantine to take sides, and everybody who obviously didn't support what he determined was classed as a heretic. And he established these dogmas as the basis of the church, which he was the champion of. And if anybody didn't agree, then they were going to be as brutally persecuted as they were when paganism was in power. And that's exactly what happened. And from the very early days, the woman, i.e. the ecclesiastical system, had to flee into not only the political wilderness, but it had to flee into the extremities of the Roman Empire to avoid this terrible persecution which Constantine, who had come to power with their help, was now bringing upon them, because he supported one section of the church rather than another. And it was the other section, which obviously opposed what he'd said, which opposed his doctrines, which opposed the things which he is now saying was the state church, and therefore were the witnesses of chapter 11 and verse 3, who have obviously witnessed against him for the period of 1260 days, until finally they got their way, and of course it was the Catholic Church which overthrew the Protestant power, and obviously, for a time anyway, was supreme once again. But that's exactly what we've got in verse 6 of chapter 12. Verse 12 says, "Therefore rejoice, ye heavens, and ye that dwell in them. Woe to the inhabitants of the earth and the sea, for the devil is come down unto you, having great wrath, because he know that he hath but a short time. And when the dragon saw that he was cast unto the earth, he persecuted the woman which brought forth the man child." We can understand verse 12 quite easily. The ones who had ascended now to the political power were rejoicing. Those who were supportive of Constantine, who accepted his dogmas and his decrees, were obviously rejoicing to those of the people, of the peoples, nations, kingdom and tongues, which comprised the earth and the sea of the ruled inhabitants of the day. "The devil is come down unto you having great wrath, because he knoweth that he hath but a short time." And then in verse 13, "And when the dragon saw that he was cast unto the earth, he persecuted the woman which brought forth the man-child." Now, take your thoughts back to verse 9. The dragon was cast out unto the earth, and his angels were cast out with him. Now again, to take your thoughts back to chapter 6, and in verse 9, "The souls of them that were slain had prayed, how long dost thou not judge and avenge our blood on them that dwell upon the earth?" And now we have the situation. Whereas they obviously had been liberated, we find now in verse 13 that the dragon who was cast unto the earth persecuted the woman. Now, we've already been told in verse 12, "He hath but a short time to live." Paganism and its adherents were overthrown. As we've said, it was not an immediate one battle over and done with black and white situation. It took a period of time. And during the period of time, because he knew that he'd only got a short space, there was this persecution of the woman which brought forth the man-child. But you'll notice in verse 14, "The woman was given two wings of a great eagle, that she might fly into the wilderness, into her place, where she is nourished for a time, times, and half a time, from the face of the serpent. And the serpent cast out of his mouth water as a flood, that he might cause her to be carried away of the flood." Now the symbology here we have covered, but we'll go through it so you'll understand what it's saying. Now, first of all, can I take you back to Deuteronomy 28, verse 49. Yahweh shall bring a nation against thee from far, from the end of the earth, as swift as the eagle flieth. And the power identified from verse 49 onwards is obviously the Roman power in the prophecy of Moses here. And therefore Rome, as we know from its symbol, is identified as the eagle. Verse 52 is obviously speaking about AD 70. He shall besiege thee in all thy gates, until thy high and fenced walls come down, wherein thy trusteth throughout all the land. And he shall besiege thee in all thy gates throughout all thy land, which Yahweh thy God giveth thee. It's the Roman power coming against the nation of Israel. And therefore, in verse 49, he's identified as being as swift as the eagle flieth. Now, in verse 14 of chapter 12, to this woman was given the two wings of a great eagle, the symbol of Rome. And this was given unto her that she might go into the wilderness.